You say, heaven, can I have help?
Yes.
Tell me out loud.
Yes.
Yes and amen in your life.
Yes.
Young people, I appreciate that you are not clapping. You are well controlled this year, and you'll be climbing up this year in Jesus' name.
Yes.
And any exam you take this year, the answer is yes. Any form you feel this year, the answer is yes. And then those great desires of your parents and of yourself and of my humble self for you, everything is yes. Mothers and fathers, this year is a year of yes. A year of progress. And the Lord's hand will be upon us in Jesus' name. Our missionaries and ministers, this is a year of yes. Close your eyes, we're going to pray. Father, we thank you for this day. We bless your name for your people. You've led us to this new year, and we know something great, something marvelous, and something unforgettable will happen in every life in Jesus' name. We pray, Lord, this year you will lead your people. You lead everyone to the fountain of living waters. There'll be no lack in any life. There'll be no failure in any life. There'll be no backsliding in any family. Lord, we pray there'll be fruit coming into the kingdom this year in Jesus' name. Our pastors, our overseers, our full-time workers, our regular workers, and everybody, Lord, I pray they will find something in every life, that they will know that this is a year of yes and amen. Well, thank you, because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. God bless you. You can sit down. We're reading from Numbers chapter 10. And verse 29, Numbers chapter 10, verse 29. And Moses said unto Hobab, the son of Reguel, the Midianite, Moses' father-in-law, we are journeying unto the place of the which the Lord said, I will give it you. He'll give you something this year. Come thou with us, and we will do thee good for the Lord concerning Israel. I come to tell you today, the Lord has spoken something good about you, and that good thing he has spoken concerning you will be fulfilled in Jesus' name. We are journeying unto the place of which the Lord said, I will give it you. We are on a journey, and as we're on this journey, we need strength and we need focus, and we need to have direction and control, so that that place the Lord had already ordained that you will get to this year, you will not miss it. I will not miss mine. We are on a journey, and as we are talking about renewed strength for the heavenward journey. Renewed strength for the heavenward journey. Our journey is to the promised land. Our journey is to heaven. It is heavenward. We need strength. We need focus. We need understanding. We need the partnership of God. We need the promise of God. We need the power of God. And we need his directing spirit every time, saying, this is the way. Don't go that way. This is the way. Don't turn that way. This is the way. And as we listen to him, I will follow him, or reach where he's taking us to in Jesus' name. Renewed strength for the heavenward journey. There are three points we're looking at before we pray. Recovering strength by feeding on the heavenly manna. Recovering strength by feeding on the heavenly manna. Number two, releasing saints to follow the heavenly master. He knows the way. He's been there before. He knows where your blessing is. He knows where the fulfillment of your life will come. He knows where the realization of the dream of your life will be. And as he leads you, as the master, the heavenly master, the then you are released to follow this heavenly master to that ordained place. Number three, renewing the spirit to fulfill the heavenly mandate. Renewing the spirit to fulfill the heavenly mandate. Everyone God creates in this world, God creates and God sends into the world for a particular purpose. And now, if immediately you are born again, that purpose is even re-established. And as you are a child of God, you ought to understand you are not just there, and you are not an accident, and you are not just there by chance. You are here because the Lord himself has appointed, has ordained that you will be there. And you are born into the kingdom, and you are in the kingdom for such a time as this. Now there is a heavenly mandate. I cannot do what God has appointed you to do. You cannot do what God has appointed me to do. No matter how high you go, and no matter how great you walk, I should not be jealous of you, because as high as you go, that's the ordination of God for you. That's a mandate of God for you. And I may go far, you're not jealous of me. Why? Because that's what God has ordained for me to do. You will not disturb me, and by the grace of God, I will not disturb you. And as I see the Spirit of God in your life and the glory of God in your life, because I see that already on you. Somebody that says, see that glory of God upon you, and then you're moving up and moving up. I'll be encouraging you and say, keep on climbing, keep on climbing. You are not there yet until you are there, because you'll be there in Jesus' name. Let's help each other. Let's encourage one another. And let's encourage that other brother, no matter how high they are going. You know that that is the heavenly mandate for them, and you're renewing their spirit. You're encouraging them, enlightening them, so that they will reach that place the Lord has ordained for them. There are three things. Number one now, recovering strength by feeding on the heavenly manna. Let's come to 1 Kings chapter 19. In 1 Kings chapter 19, we're reading from verse 5. God had a purpose for Elijah, just like he has for you. God had a destiny for Elijah, just like he had for you. But there were some surrounding circumstances and situations that made him to become discouraged. And because of that discouragement, he was going the wrong direction. Then he was lying down, all strength gone, and all the vision he had before, everything gone, and all the passion he had in his heart, and all the kind of consecration. I will climb that mountain, I will get there, I'll destroy those false prophets, I'll destroy false worship. When he heard about the threats of Jezebel, then he went away and just lay somewhere. Look at chapter 19, 1 Kings, verse 5. And as he lay and slept under a juniper tree, behold, there came. Then an angel touched him and said unto him, arise and eat. When no human being could come for encouragement, and could come for nourishment, and could come for raising him up and encouraging him to be what he ought to be, an angel came from heaven. You will not lack encouragement this year. Even if God has to send an angel to you, invisible, you might not see, but that invisible hand will direct you this year. And he said, arise and eat. He needed to recover strength by feeding on this heavenly manna. And he looked, and behold, there was a cake baking on the coals, and a cruse of water at his head. And he did eat and drink, and laid him down again. That was not enough. And now, because he's not got enough strength, the Lord will not stop feeding you this year, nourishing you this year, and giving you everything you need until you come to that premium, maximum level, and God will say, now you've got it, you can go. Somebody there. Now you've got it, now you can go. I'm telling you, you will run this year, you will not be weary. You will walk, you will not be tired. And then all the disappointment of the past, this year, I see the glory. I see the strength. And I see the power. And I see that we are climbing up this year in Jesus' name. Verse 7, the angel of the Lord came again the second time and touched him and said, arise and eat, because the journey, you see that life is a journey. You see that ministry is a journey. You see that when you endeavor to do something, it's like you're going on a journey, and you need milestones, and you need the strength to carry you through. And it is not where you were last month that you will be today. It's not where you were last year that you will be today, because it's a journey. And it says, because the journey is too great for me. And he arose, and he did eat, and he did drink, and went in the strength of that meat. He went in the strength of the angel's food. He went in the strength of that heavenly manna, 40 days and 40 nights, unto Horeb, the mount of God. He got there. I am getting there. I said, I am getting there. And look at this in Psalm 78. Psalm 78. And we're reading from verse 23. Psalm 78. We're reading from verse 23. Though he had commanded the clouds from above and opened the doors of heaven. It's talking about the children of Israel. They too, they were on a journey. They were going from Egypt to the promised land. And that's why Moses told Oba, the son of Phinehas, he said, come along with us, because we are journeying unto the place where the Lord has said, I will give unto you. And for them to get there, they needed this heavenly manna. And for you to get to the place he's sending you to, you need this heavenly manna. In verse 24, and had rained down manna upon them to eat, and had given them the corn of heaven. You see that? He had given them the corn of heaven. What does that mean? Look at verse 25. Man did eat angel's food. Heavenly manna. Heavenly manna. And it's not exhausted yet. It's still there. And it will give you strength this year. The word you take it, for man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God shall man live. Man did eat angel's food, and he sent them meat to the full. It will fill you up. But you must take time to take that food. You must take time to receive that heavenly manna. In Mark chapter 6, Mark chapter 6, I'm reading from verse 30. Mark chapter 6, reading from verse 30. And the apostles gathered themselves together unto Jesus and told him all things, both what they had done and what they had taught. And he said unto them, come ye yourselves apart into a desert place and rest a while. Come ye yourselves apart into a desert place and rest a while. For there were many coming and going, and they had no leisure, no time to so much as to eat. You see, the people that need help, they're always coming for help. Help me. Pray for me. Counsel me, teach me, feed me, sing to me, do this and do that. They do not realize that those ministers, those singers, and those people that are ministering to their needs, they do not understand. They also need some time to feed on the word of God. You see, you know, the GS, you know, just finished all that retreat. What wasn't that a wonderful retreat? And God had given him the strength. And then after that, we went to the Congress. And then morning, afternoon, evening, three times a day, and preached the word. Isn't that wonderful? Pastor, right on. We're praying for you. And then we finished on Saturday and the following day, Sunday. Here we are for the combined service. And then Monday Bible study. Then they announced and they said tomorrow there will be no combined Monday Bible study here because and the pastor is in town. What's he going to be doing? Is he going to be sleeping? Well, you come and ask me next week, I'll tell you. But you know, the Lord is saying, come ye yourselves apart. There are times we need a little rest, a little break. Our overseers, a little rest, a little break. Our choir, a little rest and a little break. And our ushers, a little rest, a little break. And you see our, you know, technical people standing there all the time. And they go from day to day. They never complain. They never complain. And God is using them to do a great job. But we are the people to think for them and to say, come ye yourselves apart and rest a while. Because they didn't have any leisure, any time, any freedom, any vacation to eat or to recover their strength. But this year will balance up everything. Somebody there said we'll balance up everything. And so when you don't have a combined Monday Bible study here, no speculation. I see travel, I see not travel. Tomorrow is see away somewhere. No, not at all. I am here in Lagos. I'm just going to take some time apart and rest a while. Because you know I need to recover strength after all those strenuous days. We're going to take some time. And then sometimes you might come to the Bible study and then we give the choir time to rest, a be offended. No, not at all. You don't understand. Like that song they rendered now, it's not just something, just go there for 2 minutes and then say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, do re mi so and all that, and then we're back. No, for hours. It takes them hours. And then they've gone through the retreat for hours. They practice every day and every night. And then they go through the Congress hours and days they're practicing. And if we say, well, we know you need rest. Some of them are married, maybe all of them. If you are not married yet, I'm praying for you this year. Yes. Marriage. I said marriage. Yes. Good husband for you. Yes. A good wife for you in Jesus' name. Yes. And those who are not married yet, you know, you see me and I'll create the time. Maybe I'll come and sing with you in that private place and then, don't clap. And then I'll pray for all of you because I'm interested in everyone. That this year, all the cries of your heart, the Lord is going to fulfill in Jesus' name. And so, it's not that we're unhappy or angry at anybody. We're just wanting to make sure that those who need some rest, and not perpetual rest, just rest for a little time. Rest for a little time here so that we all recover strength. I'll do it for myself. I'll do it for you. I'll do it for the choir. I'll do it for everybody so that you will be at top level of your strength this year. You're on and then you're getting to, I said, we understand. We'll wait for you. Rest a little bit. And then you say, Pastor, I'm okay. Now then we said, rise up and let's keep on moving. And we're going to do it together in Jesus' name. Look at Songs of Solomon. Songs of Solomon. I'm reading from chapter 1. Songs of Solomon chapter 1. It says in verse 6, look not upon me because I am black. Because the sun has looked upon me, my mother's children were angry with me, and they made me the keeper of the vineyards, but my own vineyard have I not kept. You see, the people who like to ride the willing horse to death. Oh, the people are willing. The people are ready. And they're willing to do anything. The GS is available. The GS is willing to do anything. It's finished, you know, the Congress. And now he wants to hold crusade in that place. He's ready. He's willing. And nobody ever says, Pastor, we understand. You can rest a little bit. Pastor, we understand. You need to recover strength. And nobody ever tells all our other workers, we understand. We need to give you time. because they have been spending and expending all the energy they have. And it says, my mother's children, they were angry at me. You think the people are happy at you when they say, keep on moving, keep on moving, keep on moving. When they say, keep on exercising that gift, exercising that gift. And you don't have any chance to rest. It says, my mother's children were angry with me and they made me the keeper of many vineyards, in the plural, but my own single vineyard, my own personal life, my own personal experience, my own field have I not cultivated, my own vineyard have I not kept. That's the reason why we're going to, you know, adjust things. And when you see those adjustments, you understand that we're trying to balance up everything in our lives, everything in our families, and everything in our situation, so that, you know, you, as somebody is a women coordinator, is also a member of the choir, is also in the marriage committee, and is also in another thing, and there's no time to take care of our children, no time to take care of anything. There's no right. And that one is not like you appreciate the person, you are angry at the person, you make him so busy, you make her so busy, she cannot take care of husband or children or family or personal work. We're going to balance up everything so that by the grace of God, this work will prosper in our hands. Amen. If you're in agreement, give me a good amen. Amen. In Proverbs chapter 4, Proverbs chapter 4, I'm reading from verse 20. Proverbs chapter 4, and we're reading from verse 20. It says, my son, attend to my words, incline thine ear unto my sayings, let them not depart from thine eyes, keep them in the midst of thine heart, for they are life unto those that find them. They are life unto those that find them. And then it goes on to say, the health unto all the flesh. Health to all their flesh. I pray that this health and this strength and this rejuvenation that is coming alive again, renewal of strength, the Lord will grant to everyone. In Job chapter 23. Job chapter 23, here we're reading from verse 12. Job chapter 23, and we're reading from verse 12. Here the word of God says concerning this Job, here was his commitment, and here should be your commitment. Neither have I gone back from the commandment of his lips. From the commandment of the lips of the Lord, I have esteemed the word of his mouth, the word of God, more than my necessary food. I have esteemed the word of the mouth of the Lord more than my necessary food. It's that word that gets us convicted. It's that word that gets us converted. It's that word that gets us courageous. Is that word that keeps us consecrated? Is that word that keeps us continuing in the path of righteousness? When you don't have time to even have quiet time yourself, no time to look at the word of God, and no time to benefit from the word of God, and no time to feed on this heavenly manner, how will you have conviction? How will you have conversion? How will you have the courage to move on and the courage to live the life that is glorifying unto the Lord? How will you be so committed and say, this is what I know to be true and I'm going to follow it until the end of my life? But if there's no conviction, if you didn't have any personal knowledge to internalize the word in your life, what other people are doing, that's what you do. And then if other people come and they say another thing, that's what you do. But when you say, this is the way, and this is the will of God, because I learned that at the feet of the Lord Jesus Christ, I have conviction. That's how Daniel purposed in his heart, that he will not defile himself with the meat of that the king was giving them. And then he requested of him, you know, that he will not defile himself. Conviction, building up that conviction within your heart as you personally take the word of God, and the courage and the conversion and the consecration and the commitment for the rest of your life. It tells us in Colossians chapter 3, Colossians chapter 3, We're reading from verse 16, Colossians chapter 3. Reading from verse 16, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. Singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. I doubt whether you ever do that. Whether you ever do that. You know, you just listen to other people doing the singing. And then you, when you come here, you might sing from the book. You are not singing from your heart. You are, you know, singing and looking here and looking there. And the meaning of the words do not dawn on you to say that here is the depth of theology in this word. And as you see the depth of theology, and then you appreciate what that song is saying. You appreciate, fill my cup, Lord. You're thirsty and you're hungry. You want him to fill your cup to overflow. You read that, you sing that, you read that, you sing that, and it's going to the Lord like melody unto the Lord. It says, you're speaking to one another and to yourself, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. And whatsoever you do, in word or deed, you do all to in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by him. Heavenly manna, the word of God, the word of life, the one that gives strength. In First Peter chapter 2, reading from verse 1, it says, wherefore laying aside all malice, if you're going to take in the word, if you're going to benefit from the word, if the word is going to have any impact on your life, to give you strength and stamina and to give you courage and boldness, you lay aside all malice, all guile, all hypocrisies, all envies and all evil speaking, as newborn babes desire the sincere milk of the word, that she may grow thereby. You're born again, you're saved. You move on to sanctification. And then you move on to strength. You move on until you find it to be your sufficiency. Salvation through the word. Sanctification through the word. Strength, stamina, courage and boldness with conviction through the word. And then sufficiency. Anywhere you turn, you find that there is a promise of God given unto you. You've been studying that word. You've been reading that word. You've been digesting that word. You have been personalizing. You have been internalizing that word in your life. And anything that bumps at you, anything that strikes you, there's always a promise of God. There's always a word of God that addresses that situation. Look at verse 9. In verse 9 it says, but ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, an holy nation. Then it says a peculiar people. That's what makes you peculiar. Peculiar in courage, peculiar in conviction, and peculiar in your supplication, in your prayer, peculiar in your stand, peculiar. You have a backbone that other people do not have. Other people are like jellyfish, amphibians. They are neither there nor here. But when you are storing the word in your heart, saturating your mind, your heart in the word of God, makes you peculiar. And people will see that no wind blows that disturbs you. And there's no temptation that comes and floods you. And there's no challenge that comes and destroys your life. It says, peculiar people, that ye should show forth the praises of him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. This year, you are strong. Amen. This year, the might of the Lord will walk in your life in Jesus' name. You're not in a hurry this year to rush out in the morning. You have good, wonderful devotional time and good, wonderful, quiet time that you must eat that food. It's the thing that prepares you for what is going to happen during the day. God talks to you through his word. You talk to God through prayer. And when you marry those two things together, you'll be an explosive power. A dynamite for the Lord. The word of God is inside you. And during the day, the devil comes and he says, why don't you do this? You look at that messenger of Satan, eyeball to eyeball, and you say, it is reaching. It will floor them. I said it will floor them. And then you go to another corner, one lady somewhere standing by the street side and exposing something that should be covered up, and is saying, Mister, do you, before she finishes the sentence, say, thus says the Lord. I'm sorry, I didn't know you are a prophet. Yes, I am. I didn't know you are a preacher. Somebody there, any preacher there today? I didn't know you are a preacher. And they'll get out of your way. And then when they even see, they see your face, they see the fire of the Holy Ghost coming out of those eyes, it will burn every evil thing around you in Jesus' name. That's the way God wants us to live this year. He wants us to live in power. He wants us to live with a dynamite inside us. And it is the word that will keep inside us, that does that, the hammer that will shatter every evil sin, and the fire that will burn every evil sin out of your life, out of your surrounding. It will happen. Yes. I said it will happen. Yes. This year will be a year of victory for you. Victory over temptation, and victory over the tempter, and victory over the temptress in Jesus' name. Look at Jeremiah chapter 23. Jeremiah chapter 23, I'm reading from verse 29. Is not my word like as a fire, says the Lord, and like a hammer that breaketh the rocks in pieces? The word of the Lord will break and shatter everything away from your life this year in Jesus' name. You'll not be waiting in one corner there, I'm suffering, somebody to come and pray for me. The word of God will come out of you, and when the word comes, Satan will run away from your life in Jesus' name. I'm looking at Acts of the Apostles chapter 20 verse 32. Acts chapter 20, and we're reading from verse 32. Acts 20. And we're reading from verse 32. Here it tells us in verse 32, now, brethren, I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up. The word you read in the morning, the word you take in the morning, able to build you up and to give you an inheritance among them, among all them which are sanctified. I come to point number two, releasing saints to follow the heavenly master. Releasing saints to follow the heavenly master. Following takes movement. Following demands motion. And you see the master, the heavenly master in front of you, and he says, follow me, and I will make you. He's going to make you into something this year. I said it's going to make you into something this year. It will take a process. It will first of all melt you down. It will melt you. And then it will mold you. It's going to monitor your life. You see, when Jesus said, follow me, he wanted to get them to the process. Number one, melt them. And then that's why Peter fell down on his face and said, depart from me, O Lord, because I am a sinner. He saw the hand of God. He saw the power of God. That man was melted. And Jesus said, don't worry, get up, follow me. I'm going to make you, from now on, you will catch men, melt him. And then to mold him. And while he's molding you, every message you hear, every song you hear, and every Sunday scripture teaching you have, every question and answer you have, everything you have, the Lord is molding you. And then if there is anything that mars the vessel, is going, is monitoring, it will monitor your life and monitor your action and monitor your ways, and then it's going to correct things, it's going to modify things as it sees fit, and eventually it makes you and it matures you and it mentors your life. And it is that maturing and mentoring that helps you to be following. But if your feet are tied, even though the master is in front, you cannot follow. If your hands are tied, even though the heavenly master is there, you cannot follow. If your mind is tied, if your spirit is in prison and you are confined and there's a restraint, you cannot follow. If there's somebody that is tying rope in your leg and then is pulling you this way while the master is going that way, you cannot follow. To follow the heavenly master will demand, number one, a release. Release the sins. Break those shackles. Break all those chains and all the sins you see tying them down and restraining them and pulling them back. Break everything. Release those sins so that they can follow the heavenly master. Watch your life this year. If you know there is, you know, a personality that ties you down, a personality that wants to be in control, a personality that wants to replace Christ, the heavenly master, in your life. If you see that there is a Pharisee, there is a Sadducee, and they put you in the confinement, and then they confine you there, and the master is going, the heavenly master is going, you cannot follow. You will have to get out of that confinement and get out of that imprisonment so that you can follow the master. Release the saints so that they can follow the heavenly master. Look at Acts of the Apostles chapter 12. Acts of the Apostles chapter 12. I'm reading from verse 7. Acts chapter 12 verse 7. Check up your life this year. What ties you down? What holds you back? What chain or shackles are affecting your life, tying you down? Acts of the Apostles chapter 12 verse 7. And behold, the angel of the Lord came upon him, and a light shined in the prison, and he smote Peter on the side and raised him up, saying, arise up quickly. And his chains fell off from his hands. Before those chains fell off, before that release, there's no way you could follow. And before those chains fall off from your hands, the chains fall off from your feet, and the chains fall off from your mind, there are people, they want you to look away from Jesus, the author and the finisher of your faith. There are people, they want you to give up the control of Christ, your heavenly master. They want to control your life. They want to control what you say. They want to control what you do. They want to control what your focus is. They want to control what you believe. They want to control what you declare. They want to control what your convictions are. And they tie you down. And you cannot follow the heavenly master this year, because the heavenly master, he is going, is the narrow way, is the heavenly way, is the highway of holiness. You cannot follow that path if you are tied down by anybody, anything. And here you find Peter. Look at verse 8. And the angel said unto him, gird thyself, bind on thy sandals. And so he did. And he says unto him, cast thy garment about thee, and tell me, and tell me, follow me. But the release has to take place first. And that's why you look at this year and you say, this year is going to be a year of following the master. A year of freedom. Freedom and release from all the things that bound you in the past. And you're saying, I'm going to follow him. I'm going to follow him. He will take you places. He will do things. He will command you days in the way. And the people whose eyes are closed, the people whose minds are closed, and the people whose hearts are deadened, they will not understand. And they'll say, hey, come back, come back. You are going too far. I am still here. They want to tell you that. You say, if you want to stay there, stay there. I am going up. Somebody there today, I am going where? You're going up. You'll go up in Jesus' name. Verse 9, and he went out and followed him. He went out and followed him. You need a release before you can follow. And then you'll find the things that have tied you down, the things that have held you back. A friend, he has so much control over your life. A neighbor, he has so much say over your life. A relative, he has so much retarding effect on your life. And no matter how you pray, no matter what consecration you make, he knows where to press the button that will deflate all your balloon. He knows what to do that will discourage you and make you almost to crumble right there. Identify that so-called friend. Identify so-called relative and look at that relative and that friend eyeball to eyeball and say, long enough, you have control. I said I was saved. I said I was sanctified. I said I was scriptural. I said I was saturated with scripture. But all the prayer I pray, all the decisions I make, all the places I wanted to go, you have succeeded in pulling me back. This year, I take the control of my life out of your hand. And when you say that, you mean it. And when they do the old trick, and they go the old direction, and they still want to tie you down to the past year and to past experience, you look at your leg, you say, now I can run. The chains are broken. You look at your hands, the shackles are broken. You look at your mind is centered in heaven. Your mind is focused on heaven. And because of that, you say, I'll surprise you that your cords don't bind me anymore. Your chains don't tie me down anymore. Open your eyes and look and see me run. And then you run the way of righteousness, and that fellow knows he has lost you. I'm talking to somebody there today. That fellow has lost you. The control of your life is in the hand now of the heavenly master, and you will do his will in Jesus' name. Look at Isaiah chapter 52. Isaiah chapter 52. And I'm reading from verse 1. Isaiah chapter 52. We're reading here from verse 1. Awake. Somebody is waking up. Awake. Put on thy strength, O Zion. Thank God I am strong. I say, thank God I am strong. Let the weak say. Let him say it as if he was really strong. You're strong in Jesus' name. Put on thy strength. Put on thy beautiful garments, O Jerusalem, the holy city. For henceforth there shall no more come into thee an uncircumcised and the unclean. Shake thyself from the dust. Arise and sit down, O Jerusalem. Loose thyself. Nobody else will do it for you. Loose thyself. Nobody else will do it for you. Loose thyself from the bands of thy neck, O captive daughter of Zion. It takes that release to take place. When that release takes place, then you're ready to follow. You're ready to serve. And you'll follow the Lord in Jesus' name. We're looking at the word of God in Hebrews chapter 12. Hebrews chapter 12. I'm reading verse 14. Hebrews chapter 12. Verse 14. It says, follow peace with all men, and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. You see the word there, follow. And it says, follow peace with all men. Peace with all men. How do you do that? You follow the Prince of Peace. You follow the Prince of Peace. Here is the Heavenly Master. He is the Prince of Peace. And you're not looking at conflict. You're not looking at debates. You're not looking at confrontation. You're not looking at adversary. You're not looking at persecutor. You're not looking at detractor. You're not looking at a backslider. You're not looking at a prodigal son. You're not looking at a prodigal daughter. You're not looking at anybody, anywhere, anytime. You focus your eyes on the Prince of Peace. You have nothing to do with them. All those people, they're going nowhere. They don't know. A new year has come. They don't know a new opportunity has come. They don't know a new door has opened. They don't know a new assignment has been given. They don't know a new opportunity and a new zeal has arrived. They do not know a new passion is available. They're still in the old year, in the old life. But the Prince of Peace is moving on. And then you have nothing to do with them. If you don't respond to their quarreling, the quarreling will die down. If you don't feed that fire, the fire will die down. If you don't feed that debate, if they're ready to debate and you are not giving response to that debate, the debate will die down. And then you keep on. It's the way of peace this year. It's the path of peace this year. It's the Prince of Peace this year. Look at the title of Jesus Christ. I'm reading to you from Isaiah chapter 9. Isaiah chapter 9. And we're reading here from verse 6. Talking about Jesus Christ. And it says, for unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father. Tell me the last title there. Tell me out loud. If he lives in your heart, tell me his name. If he's there controlling your life, tell me out loud. If those insinuators and if those persecutors and if those debaters and if those scoffers, if they're not in control of your life and your eyes are fixed on this one, the heavenly master, tell me his title. The Prince of Peace. He lives inside my heart. He speaks into my ears. He gives me a sight of peace. And he says, leave the storm with me. I will calm the storm. Don't be diverted to that individual, by that individual, through that individual. Just keep on looking at the Prince of Peace and you'll follow peace with all men. Look at this. Come back to Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 14. It says, follow peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. How do you have that holiness? Well, it's by looking at the heavenly master. Is the Holy One. Look at what it says in Hebrews chapter 7. Hebrews chapter 7, we're reading from verse 26. For such an high priest became us who is holy. That's the master who is holy. That's Jesus Christ who is holy. That's the Prince of Peace. And because you're asking yourself, what will Christ do? How will Christ respond to this? Will Christ touch this? Take this? Will Christ yield to this temptation? Will Christ go this direction? Because you're looking at the Holy One. The Holy One all the time is holy. And he's harmless, and he's undefiled, and he's separate from sinners, made higher than the heavens, because that's the one you're looking at. That's the one you focus on. That's the one you put your trust and confidence and faith on. You're not diverted by anything, by anybody. And because you're looking at the Holy One, the Heavenly Master, and that makes you then holy. I'm looking at Acts of the Apostles chapter 3 verse 14. Acts of the Apostles chapter 3, and we're reading from verse 14. Acts 3, 14. Here is what it says. It's talking about that Jesus Christ. And see what this verse calls him in verse 14. It says, but she denied the Holy One. The Holy One. He is the Holy One. What do I do to follow holiness at all times? All I need to do is have partnership with this Holy One. And lean on this Holy One, and have the mind of this Holy One, and have the words of this Holy One, and have the counsel of this Holy One, and have the impartation and the influence of this Holy One. That's all it takes. No separation between you and Christ. Temptations come, you are not looking at temptation, you are looking at the Holy One. And diversions came, you are not looking at those diversions, at distractions, you are looking at this Holy One. And people want to provoke you and get you into old year fighting, old time fighting. You're not looking at the fight, you're looking at the Holy One. You'll be holy through and through. Your heart will be holy. Your mind will be holy. Your intentions will be holy. Your imagination will be holy. Your direction will be holy. The words of your mouth will be holy. You'll be able to follow peace with all men and holiness without which no man shall see the Lord. And if you find that in the past year, you had gone a direction that wasn't good and you had created some problems, you don't leave those problems there, because the remembrance of those problems will bind you. You will not be released to follow on, follow the heavenly master. And you see sometimes, for example, maybe at home, husband and wife, you are angry at each other. And then you say some unprintable words against each other. And then you say things that you don't want to remember, because every time you remember, it binds your heart. You're not free. And then when you want to speak to your wife, you say maybe she remembers those things I said. Maybe it's disturbing her mind, but you have not released yourself from that. How do you release yourself? Look at Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5, I'm reading from verse 22. Matthew chapter 5, verse 22. Look at what it says here. The words of the heavenly master. It says, you want to be released so you can follow me. It says, but I say unto you that whosoever is angry with his brother, whosoever is angry with his sister, why don't you bring it home? Whosoever is angry with his wife, whosoever is angry with his with her husband without a cause, shall be in danger of the judgment. And whosoever shall say to his brother, Raka, a bad word, an abusive word, an insulting word, and you say to somebody, a brother, a sister, a neighbor, he'll be in danger of the council. And whosoever shall say, thou fool, you look at somebody face to face and you point at him like this and you say, thou fool. And when you say that, you are angry. You might say it methodically, but there's something that's in your heart. You are angry. You might say it in a diplomatic way and say, you know, there are many fools around, and the fellow knows you are talking about him. You're still saying the same thing, only that you are just using the method to say, thou fool. You are angry at something. Before you can call your husband a fool, your wife a fool, foolish child, before you can call that child a fool, before you can call our workers, our leaders, before you can call anyone that does something a fool, and you think you are bold, and you think you are courageous, and you are able to come to them because you have learned language, you have read the world's literature, and you know how to say it in the world's teaching, that you might say it indirectly, but you say it pointedly, pungently. The fellow knows you are talking to him, you are talking to a doubtful. It says, you'll be in danger of hell fire. You see, all that ties you down. All those actions. Now, if it's not just thou fool, but you have stolen. If it's not just thou fool, you've committed fornication. If it's not just thou fool, you've committed adultery. If it is not thou just thou fool, you have taken somebody's life. You have committed murder. If it is not just thou fool, you have the love of money that is the root of all evil. All those things are there. The new year, hold on. You must be released from the chains and the shackles of the past life. How do you get that done? Number one, repentance. Number two, restitution. Number three, reconciliation. Look at verse 23. Therefore, if thou bring thy gift to the altar, and there rememberest that thy brother, thy wife, thy husband, thy children, thy parents, thy leader, your leaders in the church have ought against thee, leave there thy gift before the altar. That's restitution now. and go thy way, and first be reconciled to thy brother, and then come and offer thy gift. Repentance, restitution, reconciliation. That's what the Lord taught. It is that that then releases you from the old guilt and the old condemnation, and now you're free as the bird flying in the air, and you will get somewhere. I'm talking to somebody. I say you'll get somewhere, but there must be repentance. And repentance means you so turn away from those old tricks and from those old insults and from those old abuses and from those old terrible evil character, habitual evil character. You turn away from them, and then you make right the past, so that now you're free to move on in the new life. First Peter chapter 2, we're reading from verse 21. For even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example, that ye should follow his steps. He wants us to follow. We're going to follow. I said we're going to follow. You follow his step. That means you'll ask yourself, when we come to worship the Lord, and we need to worship in spirit and in truth, how will Christ want me to worship? How will Christ worship the Heavenly Father? He'll worship him without any distraction. And if I'm going to follow his footsteps, I want to do the same thing. And I want to help other people to do the same thing and worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. Look at verse 22. Who did not sin, they were not sin. Neither was guile, lying, deception, deceit found in his mouth. And so lies and deceit, deception, guile will not be found in our mouth. Who, when he was reviled, reviled not again. No retaliation in the life of Christ, and no retaliation in our lives. When he suffered, he threatened not, but he committed himself to him that judgeth righteously, who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we being dead to sin, sin will not excite us this year, will not influence us this year, will not make us get up and, you know, want to go and touch the untouchable this year, in Jesus' name. Being dead to sin should live unto righteousness. Live unto righteousness. And we're told here, by his stripes, tell me the rest, we're healed. We're looking at Revelation chapter 14. Revelation chapter 14. We're reading from verse 4. Revelation chapter 14. Reading from verse 4. These are they which were not defiled with women. These are they which were not defiled with women. And then he goes on to tell us that they follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth. Not defiled with women. What does that mean? You know what it means? Women in pictures. They are not there, but the pictures are there. You don't defile yourself with them. Women on the internet. They are not there physically with you, but they could defile you. Those women on the internet. You know where they sometimes they just pop up. You're doing a normal thing. You're browsing a normal thing, and then they just pop up. Well, you're not guilty because you were not looking for that. But now, when you then follow through, and it goes, says, punch this, you punch that, you go that, you go that, you go there. Now you are defiled. You dream. You imagine bad things. But the people who are following the Master, the Heavenly Master, they are not defiled with women, and they're not defiled with men either. And then, if it's not on the internet, it's on the street. In the corners of the street. You're not saying, I want to pass through that way. Maybe it'll be there. Why do you want to pass this? Why don't you go this other way? Your heart is looking for defilement. But this year you make up your mind, if they are there, I'm off, I'm this way. And now, not only on the street, in your house, your maid in your house, the helpers in your house, wife is going to market, wife is going to work, and you're just there. Be careful. If your hand causes you to offend, cut it off. Your eyes cause you to offend, pluck it out. If you know that that lady that is helping in the house will not allow you to get to heaven, then dismiss her. And maybe you take over the cooking and the home housekeeping yourself. It is that serious if you're going to get to heaven, that you'll not be defiled by anyone, a man, a woman, or money. The people who are defiled with money, look at that verse. I'm going to go to 1 Timothy, but look at this. It says, these are they which were not defiled with women, for they are virgins. These are they which follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth. These were redeemed from among men, being the first fruits unto God and to the Lamb. 1 Timothy chapter 5, I'm reading from verse 6. 1 Timothy chapter 5, reading from verse 6. Here is what it says in verse 6. It says, but she, a woman, but she, a so-called church goer, but she, a so-called believer, but leading up, but she that liveth in pleasure is dead while she liveth. Don't you be led astray by, you know, backsliding women, the way they dress, the way they comport themselves, and the things they show that they ought to cover up, that will tempt the men and derail the men. You don't want to put your mind, your eyes on that, because there is a heavenly master and you are following that master. We're looking at 1 Timothy chapter 6. 1 Timothy chapter 6, I'm reading here from verse 6. It says, but godliness with contentment is great gain, for we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain that we can carry nothing out. Having food and raiment, let us be therewith content. But they that will be rich, they want to get rich quick. They want cheap prosperity. They want a lot of money in their bank accounts without sweat on their faces. It says, they that will be rich fall into temptation and a snare, and into many foolish and hurtful lusts which drown men in destruction and perdition. The end of it is perdition. The end of it is destruction. You see all the EFCC things going on now. And the people that had those things before, they're even throwing it away. If they could hide themselves somewhere, that those accounts will not be associated with them, they would have done that. This sin in the world here, even in the world here, is something you want to run away from. The covetousness, the perdition, the destruction. It says it drowns men in destruction and perdition for the love of money. No love for the master. Money has taken the earth. For the love of money is the root of all evil, which while some coveted after, they have erred from the faith. I will not err from the faith. You know, money can derail you. Take your mind away from Bible study. Take your mind away from the doctrines of the Bible. Take your mind away from the heavenly journey, the heavenward journey. Money. money is so terrible. It's supposed to be a servant. It becomes a master that rules over you and pierce themselves through with many sorrows. But thou, O man of God, flee these things and follow after righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, and meekness. You will. I said you will. Repentance, restitution, reconciliation. Point number three, renewing the spirit to fulfill the heavenly mandate. Renewing the spirit to fulfill the heavenly mandate. In Psalm 51, Psalm 51, reading from verse 10. Psalm 51, we're reading from verse 10. Here in verse 10, it emphasizes once again the renewal of the spirit. It says, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence. Take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and appoint me with thy free spirit. Then, after that restoration, then, after that renewal, then, after that revival, it says, then will I teach transgressors thy ways, and sinners shall be converted unto thee. Renewed spirit that helps you to now focus on the heavenly mandate. There's the heavenly mandate the Lord has given to everyone. Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. There is the heavenly mandate that God has given to you in particular. And it says, this is why you were born. This is why you were born again. And this is why you are in the kingdom for such a time like this. No other person can do that kingdom assignment on your behalf. You are the one appointed and assigned, anointed and edified and put in place of day to do that. Is the heavenly mandate for you, like Paul the apostle. For this purpose have I called him, to take my name to the Gentiles and to the kings and to the children of Israel. It was a heavenly mandate for him, and he did it, and you will do your own. Somebody there said, you will do your own. He did not fail, you will not fail. He did not falter, you will not falter. And he did not give it up, you will not give it up, in Jesus' name. On the other hand, if there is a mandate, hellish mandate, that Satan has given you, because Satan wants to take the servants of Christ and make those servants his own servants. Satan wants to take the people, Simon or Simeon, whichever one you bear, Satan has desired to have you, that he may sift you like wheat. But I'm praying for you. And Simon said, and Simeon said, don't pray for me, master, I'm all right. No, you are not all right. Satan wants to have you, and he wants to give you a hellish mandate. But you are the one to throw it away and throw that cloak away and say, that's hellish, that's horrible, I'm not going to go that way. And then you pick up the heavenly mandate and you say, I am going to heaven. Somebody there, I am going to heaven. What are you? Somebody there, I am going to heaven. Put out your hand. You know what? On the day, if the rapture delays, if the rapture doesn't take place now, on the day you are panting for your latest breath and you are gasping and we're looking at you, the fellow who is trying to give you a hellish mandate now, who is trying to withdraw you from the heavenly mandate, that fellow, even if that fellow is there, he'll not be able to help you. You're trying to breathe, you cannot breathe. You try to sustain life here, you cannot. The people that distract your attention and the people that want to hold you back from following the heavenward journey on that final day, they'll not be able to help. And they'll just abandon you like that. And when you eventually die and they're going to bury you, if anybody wants to push them, they say, why are you pushing me? Do you want me to get into the pit with him? They will not go with you. You will go there alone by yourself. And you will not say, I would have done this, I would have done that, but the sympathizers did not allow me to do that. I would have been restored. I would have given my life to Jesus Christ completely and totally. I would have followed the heavenly mandate, but the people around me, they were telling me, don't go too far, don't go too far. But this day, you want to break up the shackles and any chain that binds you to anybody, you want to say, I came into this world when I was born, naturally, into this world, did I know you? Were you there? And when I was born again and I came into the kingdom, were you there? When I came to the altar and I laid my life on the altar and I said, Lord, I will follow you, were you there? When I made entire consecration, I said, sanctify me, Lord, purify me, Lord, purge me, Lord, I will serve you for the rest of my life, were you there? And when he gave the Holy Ghost and I said, if you give me that power of the Holy Ghost, I will go everywhere, I will touch everything, I will transform the lives of many people, were you there? And when he brought you to deeper life and said, that is where to stay, I want to deepen your life, I want to deepen your conviction, and I want to get your feet and set your feet on the way that goes to heaven, were they there? And when he called you to be a pastor, when he called you to be a preacher, when he called you to be a minister, when he called you to be a missionary, I say, yes, Lord, I surrender, I surrender all to Jesus, I surrender all to him, I freely give. And then you said, I surrender my soul, my spirit, my future, my life, my possession, everything I have, were they there? And now they want to come in and they want to rubbish everything you have laid upon the altar. But Abraham, he sacrificed to the Lord and he gave it to the Lord, and the birds of prey, they came. He was awake and he drove them away. You'll drive them away from your life. The people that will hinder your commitment, hinder your consecration, hinder your devotion unto the Lord, hinder your entire total consecration being sold to the Lord and going on this heavenly journey, you're going to jettison them and throw them aside and say, if you want to follow, follow. But this year I am running. This year I am running. Somebody there, this year I am running. And the Lord will assist you with his power in Jesus' name. Isaiah chapter 40 verse 31. Isaiah chapter 40 verse 31. But they that wait upon the Lord. What are those people? I say, what are those people? The Lord bless you this year. You shall renew. Renewal time has come. It says, if you will renew your strength, they shall mount up with wings as eagles. Mount up with wings as eagles. All the chains are broken, mount up with wings as eagles. All the shackles are broken, mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run, they shall run, they shall run and not be weary. And they shall walk and they shall not faint. There's no fainting soldier this year. There's no fainting sage this year. Courageous, consecrated, and committed, and continuing, and focusing your mind on that heavenly mansion and the heavenly master and the heavenly mandate, we're going to reach there. I've made up my mind, I've made up my mind, whatever others do, I'll be there. Am I talking to somebody there? Are you like that this year? Why don't you rise up and tell the Lord, I'll be there, I'll be there, I'll be there, because this is the year of achievement, the year of power, the year of purpose, the year of prayer. Open your mouth and pray to the Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Let us train these soldiers of the Lord, say amen. This year is going to be different. The power of the Lord will sustain you. The vision of the Most High will be in front of you. You will succeed. In your spiritual life, you will succeed. Family life, you will succeed. Academic life, you will succeed. professional life you'll succeed. And every promise of God will be yes and amen in your life. God will say yes to you. The Savior will say yes to you. Holy Ghost will say yes to you. Angels will say yes to you. And we in our church here, we will not discourage you. We will lift up your hand, myself and all the ministers. We will say yes to you. Raise up those hands. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for this new year. It's going to be a year of holiness, a year of health, a year of prosperity, and a year of happiness. Oh Lord, I pray all the negative things of the past, wipe them away in Jesus' name. Strengthen everyone. Saturate everyone to power. Empower everyone in Jesus' name. I pray, Lord, that you give us the grace this year. Everyone, one by one, to follow the heavenly master. Help us, Lord, to go this way of heaven and also follow through and fulfill heavenly mandate upon our lives in Jesus' name. Lord, we're asking this year we will desire, we will take the heavenly manna. And it will bring strength, will bring courage, bring boldness, bring victory, will bring righteousness, will bring prosperity. This word will work in every life this year in Jesus' name. Strengthen everyone. Restore the backsliders. Renew the believers. And revive the body of Christ. We're asking, Lord, as your people go, they go home with the joy of the Lord. And the joy of the Lord will be your strength. When you come back, next time, you come back with testimonies. Every sickness taken away from your body. Infirmity taken away from your life. Be strong and be made whole in Jesus' name. Your wife will live. Your husband will live. Your children will live. Your parents will live. Premature death canceled from every life in Jesus' name. And everything the Lord has mandated for you to achieve this year, to the minutest detail, nothing will cause failure in Jesus' name. Joy and happiness will be waiting for you everywhere. And remain successful. Remain blessed. We love you, God loves you, and the love of God will pull you over. Lord, fulfill your will in every life and say yes to everyone. In Jesus' name we pray. Once again, happy new year, prosperous new year, and the Lord prosper your way this year in Jesus' name. If I have opportunity of seeing you anytime, you have a testimony to give me. Thank you and God bless you.